Since you've decided to take a course in blockchain, we assume that you've already heard something about it. Let's start with a historical introduction and discuss the ideas that led to the emergence of blockchain. The word blockchain itself has a number of definitions, each of them correct to a different extent. But blockchain is actually rather a general term used to describe systems similar to Bitcoin, the first successful decentralized digital currency network. The creator of Bitcoin, a collective or individual known under the pseudonym Satoshi Nakamoto, published a description of the protocol back in October 2008. The network itself was launched in January 2009. Since then, Bitcoin has drawn a lot of attention to its functionality, set in motion research into applying the technology behind it to every field of human endeavor, and has even become the subject of online courses. Thanks to this apparently sudden excitement, it might seem that Bitcoin just appeared out of the blue. In reality, the system simply combined several already existing ideas. The emergence of Bitcoin is actually the result of 30 years of scientific work in various seemingly disjointed directions. First among these directions was the idea of verifying documents by timestamping them and binding them in chains. This idea was first introduced in papers by Stuart Haber and Scott Stornetta in 1991. They planned to create something like a digital notary. Here is the core idea. It could be helpful to establish that patents, contracts, and other documents were created before a certain point in time. Haber and Stornetta proposed to solve this problem by creating an online service that lets a user send a document to the service to get a certificate proving its creation time. To provide this proof, the service uses two cryptographic primitives, digital signatures and hash functions. Hash functions, invented back in the 50s, are functions that take a message of arbitrary length as an input and return a bit string of a fixed length called a hash. We will be talking about cryptographic hash functions, which are hash functions with the following qualities. First, determinism. They always return the same hash for the same input message. Second, irreversibility. That is, the impossibility to calculate the source message using only the hash. Third, collision resistance, meaning it is unfeasible to find two messages with the same hash. A crucial quality of hash functions is that they constitute a representation of data in an encrypted and compressed form, otherwise known as a digest. Even a minor alteration to the data leads to a complete change in the hash. The second primitive, the digital signature, was first proposed by Whitfield Diffie and Martin Hellman in 1976. It is a method of proving the authorship of a message with a pair of keys, one private and one public. Using the private key in the message, the author produces a signature that he sends along with the message. The recipient can then use the public key to verify that the signature was indeed produced from the message using the corresponding private key. That way, the recipient can be sure that the sender has the private key. So how did Haber and Stornetta propose to use those primitives to provide timestamping services? First, to keep the content of the document private, instead of sending the document itself, the user sends its hash. The timestamping service appends this hash with a timestamp as well as the hash of the previously processed document. Then, to prove that the document was indeed processed, the timestamping service signs all that data and sends a certificate to the user. The most important part here is the inclusion of the hash of the previous document. This creates a chain of certificates, and each certificate links to the previous one. Since a digital signature is designed in such a way that its validity depends on the document's contents, whenever somebody tries to change one of the documents or the timestamp, it breaks the whole chain. Throughout the 1990s, Haber and Stornetta wrote several more papers suggesting new approaches to developing and enhancing their idea. One improvement that Haber and Stornetta thought of, instead of linking documents one by one, why not group the ones created simultaneously, or almost simultaneously, in blocks, and then bind the blocks together? If one takes a block of documents that were created at the same time, adds the hash of the previous block to it, and then uses the hash of the resulting data, it becomes impossible to alter any document in the chain without the change being noticed, since the alteration would change the hash of the block that contains that document. Then the hash of the next block would change, and so on. Their other suggestion was to store documents inside the block using a Merkle tree, another concept implemented in the Bitcoin system 10 years later, something we will discuss in detail during this course. Merkle trees are named after Ralph Merkle, one of the leading cryptologists of the late 20th century, who came up with the idea in 1980. Merkle trees are methods of storing data not only in a compressed form, as hashes allow, but also in a form that makes it easy to check if the data contains certain information. Originally, Merkle intended for this structure to check electronic certificates stored in some global directory. This would be done so that, for example, a website could show a user a certificate and prove its authenticity. Let's take a look at how the simplest Merkle tree, a binary Merkle tree, works. Data is divided into sections. Each section is hashed. The resulting hashes are paired. The sum of every pair is hashed. New hashes are paired too, and so on, until only one hash remains. That last resulting hash is called the Merkle tree root hash, and it constitutes a digest of all collected data. So, just as with simple hashing, a change in every data section necessarily affects the root hash of the whole tree. At the same time, it is easy to check whether a certain piece of information was present in the source data. One simply needs to take the hash of the part in question and all the hashes up the tree, along with their pairs, repeat the hashing steps, and compare the final result with the root hash of the tree. To sum up, in the 1990s, Haber and Stornetta developed a system where documents with the same timestamp were hashed, grouped in a block, converted into Merkle trees inside the block, and then the blocks were linked. This data structure that guarantees the authenticity of the text itself as well as its creation timestamp corresponds to the Bitcoin data structure almost to the letter, and Nakamoto's white paper contains references to Haber and Stornetta. By the way, Haber and Stornetta's digital notary vision was eventually brought to life. Two companies, Surety in the mid-1990s and GuardTime, founded in 2007, provided timestamp validation. Both companies can also thank Haber and Stornetta for another interesting idea they implemented. They bought some advertising space in newspapers to publish Merkle tree roots. This made it possible to submit not only the document, but also all the hashes needed to validate its compliance with the published root. This way, clients had the guarantee that the root hash, a crucial part of the proof of document authenticity, was created before the date the newspaper was published. There was another line of research that became the basis of the Bitcoin system, along with Merkle trees, even though the two were completely unrelated. The second line of research was into the prevention of errors in synchronizing data between several network nodes. In other words, the research was into consensus building. The task is to reach an agreement among several network nodes on what data should be considered correct according to a certain agreed upon protocol. There are several errors that may occur during the replication process, but the most generic error category, and therefore the most difficult to prevent, is the Byzantine fault, named after the Byzantine generals problem. The original formulation of this problem comes from Turing Prize winner Leslie Lamport, who published a paper called The Byzantine Generals Problem with two co-authors in 1982. The problem was formulated as follows. On the night before a battle, some Byzantine generals, each commanding a portion of the army, try to reach an agreement on the plan of action using their messengers to pass letters among them. The main question is whether to attack or to retreat. Some generals may be traitors, and the same is true for the messengers. Traitorous generals may try to sabotage loyal generals' attempts to decide on a plan, while traitorous messengers may alter the loyal generals' letters. The solution for this is to come up with a protocol of communication and decision-making that would allow all the loyal generals to agree on the same informed decision. One can easily understand where this abstract formulation came from by replacing the generals with the nodes of a distributed network, and the messengers with the connections between those nodes. Some nodes may transmit incorrect information, sometimes in order to interfere with the network, while connections even between functioning nodes may corrupt the signal or get lost. As you can see, no exact parameters are set, so the problem might include several specific issues. The original work of Lamport and his colleagues was focused on the specific issue that assumes the connection is mostly stable, but the nodes may interfere with the network on purpose. So every deviation from the protocol is considered an error. As a result, a Byzantine fault is most commonly understood as any fault occurring in information transmission within a distributed network. In 1989, in his later work, Lamport proposed the Paxos protocol, named after an island in the Ionian Sea, whose fictional parliament became a metaphor for the protocol. The Paxos protocol could handle the problem of nodes with unstable connections, but the faults in the nodes themselves, in this case, were limited to turning off or sending outdated messages. Byzantine faults, as such, weren't taken into consideration at all. Only in 1999 did a collaborative paper by Miguel Castro and Barbara Liskov propose the PBFT protocol, PBFT standing for Practical Byzantine Fault Tolerance. This was designed for unreliable connections as well as ill-intentioned signal deviation. Since then, Paxos, PBFT, and other later protocols have been optimized time and time again. So, how does the Byzantine generals problem relate to the Bitcoin system?